Hey, welcome back. So here we are now establishing this corollary that the stochastic integral can be defined as the limit of Riemann sums. Okay, so proof is very easy now. All we do, we consider the step functions, which are just, you know, we cut our process and take the values. Then, of course, by continuity, kn minus k tends to zero pointwise. Now, what bounds it? Well, that's easy. Let's just take maximum of our process ks up to time t. And well, twice denote this by ht. This is absolutely progressively bounded process, which bounds this from above. So this integral of kn dm tends converges to integral of, well, okay, I should write km dx, sorry. The integral of km dx, let's write km of x dx of this. On one hand, this integral converges to this. On the other hand, we already computed this integral. This is just the Riemann sum. End of story. So we have our Riemann sum representation of this. And that's actually the standard definition of the integral. So usually if you look any financial mathematics textbook, for example, that's how they would define it integral. But then, of course, there is a great question why the limit exists in probability. And that's why we already build it up. The limit is actually a unique process which satisfies this duality. Okay, so now the main thing which people usually know about eta calculus is eta integral formula. And the motivation for what would happen next is this and kind of explanation, and the main point of the proof is the following formula for stochastic integration by parts, which is, well, sometimes called pre-eta formula. And you'll see an unusual thing here. So, okay, let x and y be continuous semi-martingales. So again, local martingale plus a process of bounded variation. Then xt, yt is equal to x naught, y naught plus the integral from zero to t xs dys plus integral from zero to t ys dxs. That's standard integration by parts, right? But then there is an extra term, quadratic variation of x and y. So in particular, if you take x equal to y, what would happen? Let's see. This is xt squared is equal to x naught squared plus y's integral xs dxs. Again, continuous with respect to same martingale, can do it. Plus quadratic variation of x xt. And sub example to this is that, of course, the integral of Brownian motion with respect to itself is nothing more than our old friend bt squared minus t.
as we know this martingale.
Okay, so this is a statement. Again, an unusual part here is that you also have to add quadratic variation. Why is it logical? Forget about semi-martingale. Think about local martingales. Now let's try to look at this picture. This is not quite a local martingale, right? The product of two local martingales is not local martingale. On the other hand, by definition, if y and x are local martingales, integrals with respect to them are again local martingales. So this whole thing is a local martingale. This is not. But do you remember what makes this product a local martingale? Of course, subtraction of exactly the correlation, the quadratic correlation. So that's one of the reasons why this appears here. Okay, so now this is a very simple statement. Of course, it's enough to prove it for x equal to y, right? Because then you can use polarization because both sides are happily polarized. Now let's take a subdivision as usual. And notice that this sum, which converges to quadratic variation, remember, when size of the subdivision tends to zero, it can be rewritten as this. Xt squared minus x naught squared. And then you know you just open the bracket. This is just sum of xti's times xti plus one minus xti. And now we can happily let delta go to zero. This thing, so now tends to quadratic variation. This thing is just this. And finally, this thing, by what we just proved, converges to twice the integral of xs dxs. We are done. Okay, again, so this was just from convergence of Riemann sums and definition of quadratic variation. But we get this integration by parts. Notice another thing. So let me, well, I already made this point, but I want to repeat it. That we know here that this thing, pt squared minus t, it's a martingale. We already proved it. But if you just look at this integral, all it tells us that this integral of something with respect to martingale, but not square integrable martingale. So this thing is actually not necessarily martingale. A priori, it's just a local martingale. But again, here we know that this particular integral is martingale. Okay, so now we solve this preparation. We are ready to prove its formula, and let me state it quite generally. Let us look at n continuous M martingales. So we think about it as a process in Rn. And f is a C2 function from Rn to R, or from Rn to C, doesn't matter. Then the claim is that f of xt is equal to f of x naught plus sum of the integrals of the first derivatives of f with respect to xj, integrated with respect to xj. So this would be, if you forget about stochastic integral, this would be the identity that f of xt is equal to f of x naught plus sum of all the integrals of partial derivatives. But we are talking about stochastic integral, and here what else happens? So you take all the derivatives of f with respect to any I and j, j, x, I and j, and you integrate it with respect to corresponding stochastic correlation, or maybe stochastic variation if I is equal to j. And then you sum it up and you take 1/2. Okay, so this is this thing. And this is the famous Itis formula. So again, this assumption can be weakened significantly. We wouldn't need it in this course, but there are various ways to deal with it, even if f is not C2, if it's just, say, convex function. But again, this is the formula. So the main unusual thing, if you haven't seen it before, is this integral of the second derivatives. Again, so what we will do, we first assume that each xj is bounded. How do we do it? Well, very easily, we just introduce stopping times which makes them bounded, and then let everything go to infinity. All of the sides converge, so there is no question here about this. So we can assume that each xj is bounded. Now, your f is a function which is C2 on the closure of the range of x. It's a compact set. So by Stone-Weierstrass theorem, polynomials are dense there. By slightly more sophisticated version of Stone-Weierstrass, they also dense in C2 of this compact set. So we just need to prove this statement for polynomials and then pass to the limit. Again, dominated convergence would help us. Not a problem here. By the way, here I notice that I lied to you slightly, because this is not true that polynomials are dense in the space of C2 functions on any closed set. There are some considerations here. So let's just use the fact that they are dense in the closed ball of radius r for range of x lying inside this ball. So this is definitely true. Okay, so now let's prove this for polynomials. And we do it by induction degree. Well, when degree is f and you talk about constants, nothing to prove. And now for induction step, all you need to show that if it's the statement is true for f, it's true for xj times f. And here, well, I actually called it xk, so let me correct it here. Xk times f. So we just write down that this is equal to this. This is x naught k f x naught plus integral of this df plus f dxj plus xj fx evaluated at time t. So this is just integration by parts. And now we simplify. Again, this is x not k. F of x naught plus sum over all j not equal to k xks df dxj xs plus xa xk df dxk plus f, right? I simply combined only these guys, and then you do this stochastic interval. So you just, okay, this is also xk. Oh my God, so many xk's here. So you just integrate second derivative of xkf with respect to xi xj. And that's exactly what we wanted to get. So again, I'm not doing computations of why this is equal to this, but it's again very easy to see using again the fact that the corresponding integral is isometry in H2. Okay, so that's the proof of the formula. So again, as I promised you, everything was already contained in the integration by parts. And then it's just standard things. First, you reduce to bounded, then you reduce to polynomial, then you reduce to multiplication by x, and then you just check that everything works out. Now, sometimes it's very convenient to use differential notation. So if you look at this formula, df of xt. So this is a process. This is sum of first derivatives dxj plus 1/2 sum of the second derivative dxixj. Again, it's possible to make all of this rigorous and all this, but for us, let us just assume that when I write this, you just know that it means that when you integrate left hand side and right hand side, you get the same. Another thing here, which would be clear in a moment. And this would be the following corollary. Suppose that f is a function on the plane, C2 twice differentiable continuously, and which satisfies this exciting, well, heat equation. Df dy plus 1/2 second derivative of f is equal to 0. And suppose that m is a local martingale. Then I claim that f of m and quadratic variation. So if you plug in the martingale M instead of X and its quadratic variation instead of Y, you get a local martingale. Okay, so let's see why it is true. Let's look at Zeta's formula. F of M and quadratic variation, first of all, there will be an integral with respect to M. Dm. This integral is a local martingale. Remember, integral of anything with respect to local martingale, by definition, by the way we defined it, is a local martingale. So there will be two interesting terms here, which potentially not martingale. This is the first one. This is the integral of df dy with respect to quadratic variation, because this is the second variable, this is y. There will be no correlations of this with anything. This is a process of bounded variation itself. So correlation of it with anything is just zero. So second term, the term with second derivative, you only need to take second derivative with respect to x. And this is would be 1/2 second derivative with respect to x. The same integral with respect to quadratic variation of the same thing. Look here, there is only one possible I or j, so this is just m, because again, the part which is coming from second variable is just zero. Then this non-Martingale term is equal to, well, df dy plus 1/2 second derivative of x, it's zero. So this is automatically a local Martingale again, because this part, drift term, what is called, is equal to zero. That's how we would use it a formula a lot. Well, we'll of course do other computations with this, but one of the things which would be important for us is to see, well, just to look at the drift term, to look at the term which involves Stieltjes integration and see that it disappears. Or maybe not, then we have to subtract it. Okay, so let me give you some applications of this corollary, some examples. And so this, the first example is x squared minus y, that's of course satisfies this excited problem equation. And this is our old friend. If M is a local Martingale, then MT squared minus quadratic variation, well, it's again a local Martingale. Another object which easily satisfies this, this is e to the lambda x minus lambda squared over 2y, where lambda can be any complex number. Again, plug it in, easy to see that it satisfies it. And you get this local Martingale, which is called exponential transform. If, for example, you can see that for certain lambda and for certain m, it's bounded, then you automatically get that it's Martingale, not just a local Martingale. So you can look at very nice things, expectation of exponents of M, which is very nice. It would give you Fourier transforms and the Laplace transforms and like that. So exponential transform is extremely important. Okay, so the next emphasizes. Next, I want to look at another relatively down-to-earth example. This is a d-dimensional Brownian motion. So you look, take d independent copies of no standard Brownian motion, and consider now a function f, which is twice differentiable in r plus cross rd, so r plus is the time, rd is this space variables. And then the claim is that if you look at this f transform of Brownian motion, so by definition, this is the following. You take f at the point t, and then random point b of t, and subtract integral of the half Laplacian plus df dt over the trajectory. So you integrate this over the trajectory of Brownian motion. then the claim is that this is local Martingale. In particular, when this is equal to zero, when F satisfies heat equation, then this is a local Martingale. So this is generalization of what happens here. Another thing is, if F is T independent and harmonic in RD, then F of BT now, it's also a local Martingale. So harmonic function of Brownian motion is a Martingale, is, well, local Martingale, local. Okay, and the proof is exactly the same as the proof of previous corollary. You just apply eta and you see that the drift term is this, because the only, so let me actually comment on this. For d-dimensional Brownian motion, if you take the quadratic relation of the two, it's, well, it could be zero if I is not equal to j, because they're independent. Or it could be t if they're equal to each other. So the quadratic relation is delta ij times t. So this drift term in the eta formula would just become a Laplace dt. That's why we have just ds integral here. And then this part, of course, comes from first term in the eta's formula when we take it with respect to dt. So they combine together to get this. Okay, so that if you apply harmonic function to Brownian motion, that's what would be important for me later, then you at least get local Martingale. If you manage to see that in certain up to stopping time something, your harmonic function is bounded in certain domain where you stopped your Brownian motion, then this would be honest to goodness Martingale. And then you would take mean values. This actually would be very useful in proving conformal invariance of Brownian motion. Okay, now, since we'll be talking a lot about two dimensions, we definitely need to talk a lot about complex notations. So let us look at process which is just xt plus iyt, real and imaginary part. Then zzt, well, you just take the quadratic variation, then you open the brackets and you get that it's quadratic variation of xx minus quadratic variation of yy plus 2i quadratic variation of xy. In particular, if f is the usual twice differentiable function on the complex plane, then f of zt, let's look at the eta's formula, it's f of z0 plus the integral df dz plus the integral df dz bar. And here is the integral of Laplacian. Of f at the point dt, which you integrate with respect z correlated with z bar. Again, it's very easy to see just using the Itis formula. So this is just a complex way to write it. Now, what does it mean? If Z is a local martingale, just local martingale, not Brownian motion, F is harmonic, then F of ZT is also a local martingale. Right? Because this part just disappears, and what is left is, oops, there is a misprint here, because this is, of course, integral with respect to Z bar. This part, definitely that. And what is left is constant plus integral df dz, or a function with respect to local martingale, plus another integral with respect to another local martingale, just conjugate of it. And emphasize it. So, that's it. That's our complex form of Itis formula. Now, let us move a bit further and let us try to use Itis formula to characterize Brownian motion among all d-dimensional processes. So, then I will try to convince you that any at least one dimensional continuous local martingale is time change of Brownian motion, and any nice two-dimensional martingale or complex martingale also Brownian motion, just time change. But let's start slowly. So let's start with the statement of the theorem of Paul Levy. So we start with d-dimensional adapted process. Let's start it at zero. Then the following are equivalent. First is that x is d-dimensional Brownian motion. Okay, so that's what we want to characterize. Second is that it's a continuous local martingale with the following quadratic correlations. So two guys are just uncorrelated. If I is not equal to j, quadratic correlation is zero. And if I is equal to j, quadratic correlation should be the same as for Brownian motion. And the thought process is that when you look at your continuous local martingale, so third condition, and you take at any function, and any L2 function, and you look at the exponential transform, this is exponent of I, sum of integrals from zero to tfk dxk. So you kind of integrate fk, and then you integrate fk squared with respect to what would be quadratic variation ds, except that you don't know it yet that it would be quadratic variation of x. So you look at this process. So this I, this sum, plus 1/2 sum of the integrals from zero to t fk squared of s ds, I want it to be a martingale. So if you know this or this, then you are dealing with Brownian motion. Of course, third condition is not very easy to check. Usually it's much easier to check this, but the way the proof would go, of course, one implies two, 2 implies 3, 3 would imply 1. Now, what does it mean for one-dimensional Brownian motion? It means that any continuous one-dimensional local martingale with quadratic variation equal to t is just standard Brownian motion. Okay, so I believe that's how actually Levy stated it. This is a later generalization. Okay, so now let's prove it. Well, d-dimensional Brownian motion has this correlation that we already discussed. That's by definition, because different components are just independent of each other. So one definitely implies two. That's very, very easy. Okay, so now let's see what is e to the if. So let me. Be slightly more careful. So we start with continuous local martingale with this thing. Now, if you look at this martingale, which is defined to be just integral, well, I sum of fk dxk, its quadratic variation is written here. And remember that integration is isometry. So quadratic variation of XKS, of each component of XKS, of XKS, it's already component, sorry. It's just S. So here it would become integral of FK squared DS. And then you sum them up. They're uncorrelated with each other. So the mixed terms would just die. And so let me actually write it down that. MMT is just equal to sum of fk squared integral from 0 to t fk squared ds. And then we look at the exponential transform. So let's remember the exponential transform. This is this one. We take lambda equal to 1. Oh, well, if you don't add I there, we can take lambda equal to I, doesn't matter. And, oh, okay, and then here I should add minus. Okay, so okay, let me correct this. Okay, so we take this local martingale, we take it transform. We know that it's a local martingale. But let's look at the absolute value of it. It's just this part has its exponent of I times something real, has absolute value zero. The absolute value rather one. So we are left with this. So this is integral from zero to tfk squared, but we can integrate up to infinity. We will make it even more. And we know that what we assume that each of k belongs to L2. So this is a bounded local martingale, so it is a martingale. Not just local martingale, this is very important, it's a martingale. And finally, so this of course proves that 2 implies 3. And the most interesting part of this is to prove that 3 implies 1. But again, Remember, I told you that exponential transform would allow us to easily compute Fourier transforms, and that's what would happen here. So we fix Xi in RD, we fix any T, which can be stopping time or can be just time. And let's take F to be Xi multiplied by characteristic function of zero T. So if T is just a number or expectation of T is bounded, then this function F, remember it has D component Xi is in RD, it belongs to L2. And let's look at the exponential transform of it, which we know is a martingale. So this is exponent of I times Xi multiplied by X at time what? So since we multiply by this, this is minimum of T and tau. So this is just inner product. So look at what we have to do. So we just integrate from zero to capital T. And we again add quadratic variation up to T, again up to minimum of T and T capital. Okay, so this is, we know that this is a martingale. So if A belongs to Fs and S is small, well, less or equal than T and less than T, then everything which is written here, well, there is no minimum, just T. So expectation of our characteristic function of I with respect to, well, characteristic function of I multiplied by exponent of this inner product, I xi xt minus xs, what would it be? Well, let's look here. You know that expectation of this guy at time t with respect to fs would be EIFS. So the integrals with respect to 1a of this guy for t, at time t and time s should be the same. So now we recombine it. And this, so, oh, okay, I already wrote it. This would become, well, conditional expectation of 1a with respect to this is just probability of A multiplied by exponent, well, of the difference, Xi squared over 2, T minus S. And now we know that this identity is true for any Xi in RD. So what we get? We get two things. First, that Fourier transform of xt minus xs is normal variable, is min t minus s. And it is independent of fs, because again, when you integrate with respect to characteristic function, you get back probability times this. So xt minus xs is actually normal, independent of the previous times, this this quadratic variance. So this means that it is a Brownian motion. That's it. So just by cleverly using integral transform, exponential transform, we are able to get the fact that this is
just Brownian motion.
That's it, that proves Lewis theory. And now this leads to something I already alluded to. Suppose that you have a one-dimensional continuous local martingale. And suppose that you know that it starts at zero and its quadratic variation is equal to t. Then implication 2 implies 1 in this theorem tells us that it is a Brownian motion, just a standard Brownian motion. Okay, let us do another step. Let us do a complex form, a two-dimensional version of this. So suppose that z x plus I y is a local martingale, and suppose that zz is actually zero, and xs is t. Then I claim that z is a two-dimensional Brownian motion. It's if and only if statement. So remember, for real things, this would be the death of it. This would be constant. But it's complex things, so there are correlations involved. Okay, so proof is very easy. Let's remember that ZZ, correlation of Z with itself, it's the correlation of real part, or rather variance of real part minus variance of imaginary part minus twice the correlation. So what does it mean that ZZ is equal to zero and XX is equal to T? Let's see what it means. It's equivalent to the fact that both real and imaginary part of this are dead, so they are equal to each other. So they are equal to T. On the other hand, XY is equal to zero. So X and Y are not correlated, and quadratic variation of X is the same as the quadratic variation of y is just t. So we can use two-dimensional Lewy. This is exactly two-dimensional Lewy. And it would tell us that this is a two-dimensional Brownian motion. Now realize that I forgot to mention one more condition, that of course it should start at zero. Otherwise, it's simply not true. Okay, so this is a two-dimensional Brownian motion. Okay, so this is all nice and fun, but I promised you more. I promised you that any one-dimensional local martingale, which has continuous trajectory, is a Brownian motion, reparametrized. And that's what I will prove next time, so in a week. This is a theorem of Dumbins and Dubin-Schwarz, and this is a very different Schwarz from the ones I mentioned before. This is Gideon-Schwarz and Lester Dubins. I couldn't find a picture of Dumbins. He was a Soviet mathematician. Well, probably his photo exists somewhere, but I couldn't find one which clearly states that it was him. Anyway, the theorem states that if you have a local martingale which starts at zero and which almost surely goes to infinity in quadratic variance, in quadratic variation, sorry, not variance, quadratic variation, then you can change time such that in this new time it becomes a Brownian motion. Or equivalently, this process is reparametrized Brownian motion. So you can obtain any continuous local martingale from this. But before we do this, we of course will need to carefully study change of time. This we will do next time. Okay, let me stop the recording.